Man who knows all about hanky panks. Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Ted Dombrowski.
Number two.
My name is Ted Dombrowski.
Number three.
My name is Ted Dombrowski.
And here is the story of Ted Dombrowski. Fascinating. I'm Ted Dombrowski. I'm a college professor. I have made a special study of the social subculture of the carnival. Every year, 85 million outsiders, or marks, as the old-time carny folk used to call them, are drawn to the bright lights of the Midway. There they patronize the kiddie rides, they try to toss a ping-pong ball into a goldfish bowl, they nibble a hot dog and some cotton candy, and maybe spend some time in the funhouse or at the sideshow. However, those who are with the carnival lead anything but an easy life. They spend an average of only 6 days in one spot, then move on to another. They have their own hierarchy, their rules and codes. And contrary to popular belief, they are not crooks and gyp artists. They believe in hard work and a high level of professionalism. My conclusions are not the result of casual observation. I was brought up in a carnival, and I continue to spend at least 1 month each summer actively working in the carnival world. Signed, Ted Dombrowski. Ladies and gentlemen, we will draw your attention to the one and the only Austin Bean.
Thank you. Number two, what is a geek?
A geek? Well, there are not many of them around anymore. A geek is a person who does freaky things like biting the head off a live chicken, that sort of thing. Yeah. They don't have very many of them anymore.
No, you can't find a good geek nowadays. It's true. Number three, do carnival people still yell, "Hey, Rube"?
It's an old term. It goes back many years, and the only thing I know of it, it was my dad told me about it. It goes back to the days of the original carnival and circus, where the carnival people and the circus people would stick together very tightly. And when a concessionaire or a showman was accosted by a group of ruffians to either loot him or steal something, he would yell out, "Hey, Rube," and immediately he would get support from the people, the carnies around him.
All right, I hate to cut you off, but number one, wasn't "Hey, Rube" usually when someone felt he'd been duped or had or cheated by the carnival concessionaire?
No, it's a call to arms.
All right. Number one, then, do you travel with a carnival doctor?
I'm sorry, Austin, we're going without a kitty.
Number three, why have they been thought gyps and crooks, then, if they're not?
Well, the carnival people and the circus people, per se, through the years have built up a poor reputation.
Why?
Many of the early carnivals and the early circuses, it was mentioned about marks. Well, they actually sized up people and marked individual shoppers or people who visited the carnival and went after them to take some funds from them. But, of course, it's a thing of the past.
I see. Number one, what is the hierarchy headed by? Who's the top dog in the carnival?
In the carnival, it would be the show owner, the man who owns the
rides.
And
number two, who's the next guy in charge?
Well, do you mean in charge, or?
I mean, who's the next guy in the hierarchy? Who's the most important after the owner?
Well, that's not so much fixed to occupation as it is to accomplishment. Any person who does well at his joint is.
Thank you. Number one.
And from here we go to Bill Cullen.
Number two, you mentioned that you were brought up in a carnival. Does that mean that your people were carnival people when you were born?
Yes. Yes.
Is there any such thing, number two, as new people being attracted to the carnival? I know occasionally there are, but are most carnival people who were born to that life?
I'd say most people are. Of course, people do come in, newcomers do come in, sure.
Is there, number one, is there a distinction between the people, the various jobs in the carnival? There are the performers, well, perhaps not so much at a carnival, but there are those who operate the amusement area, the rides and things like that, and those people who are vendors, who sell things like the cotton candy. Is there a difference in strata between those two groups?
Well, the ones who sell things or operate concessions think that they are better than the ones who operate the other. And in turn, the ones who operate the shows think they're better than the ones who sell things and operate concessions.
Number three.
And finally, the pick a guest.
Number three, what do you teach?
I teach social psychology.
Where?
at Temple University.
Thank you. And number two, what do you teach?
I teach American history.
Where?
At Duke in Durham, North Carolina.
Thank you. And number one, what do you teach?
I'm a social psychologist.
And where?
At Eckerd College in St. Petersburg, Florida.
Thank you. Number two, did you do your doctoral thesis in carnivals? I mean, in some phase of carnivalism?
No, in American history.
Thank you. And number three, do you have a doctorate?
Yes, I do.
What was your thesis on?
On social psychology, and it was written on the socialization of the American circus.
Oh, terrific. Number one, how much of those big dogs that you win cost, those big plush dogs?
Number three?
No, number one.
In the store?
No, at the carnival. You know, how much do you guys pay for those things that we spend $10 to win?
Some of them we spend $10 on. There are others that are less expensive.
Thank you. Now, number two, in New York, they have a thing called a...
I'm sorry. There goes our bell. It is a bona fide one, and it calls for a ballot. That means that we mark our ballots for number one or number two... or number three. And Orson, if you have a word of art with the cop, we'd love to see it. Who are you looking for?
I voted for number three, Gary. I think he looks like a college professor, and he also has a little of the leftover sawdust sticking to his shoe, I think, from the old days.
Alrighty, and the moving hand stops at three, and we go down to Kitty, please.
They're all great. I voted for number two because the way he teaches at college rolled off his tongue very easily, and he looks like a guy with a very good sense of humor that he would need to go back to the carnival every summer.
Two and a three.
There's three very bright people up here, I will say that. They all had very ready answers. I like number three's description of his thesis. I mean, he was ready for it. I don't know if he was ready or he just answered off the top, but it was good.
So, a pair of threes and a two, and Peg, how are you going?
Well, I'm not going with any of them. I thought I'd vote for number one because he's from St. Petersburg and teaches in St. Petersburg, Florida. And you know, it's warm down there, and that's where the circus is and stuff like that. So why couldn't the carnival people be down there? Smart deal, St. Petersburg, right? Anyway, I never heard of Eckerd College, so it must be there.
Is there any one of those particular reasons?
No, you can just take your pick.
I can pick any one of those reasons as your reason for voting for number one.
I don't believe I spent $10 for those dogs, though.
You want to vote for number one?
Yes.
And what's all it? Hmm?
He's cute, too.
Yeah, he's cute, too, but that's a different game. The votes are in. Will the real Ted Dombrowski please stand up? Good job, Peg. Nice job, gentlemen. Let's find out who you are. Number two, what is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Roy Brookley. I'm an architectural photographer.
Hi. And number three.
My name is Nick Rago. I'm product promotion manager for Swans and Frozen Hungry Man Dinners, a division of the Campbell Soup Company.
Well, we learned a lot, Ted. Thank you very much, and thank you, imposters, for being with us on Tell the Truth.